Morning, church. Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome to Music Sunday. It's a special day. We're all going to gather and worship our God primarily through music and prayer. We invite you to stand, sit, kneel, whatever you feel led to do, however you feel led to worship. Let's sing with God together today. With his heart open wide, from the depths, from the heights, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry, I will bring a sacrifice.
Lay me down,
oh, and on my
From the rising of the sun to the ending of the day, one name alone be praised. Every nation, tribe, and tongue, all creation lifting up your name.
Courtesy of Aubrey. These are all her favorite little songs that we sing at night. And I wanted to share a story. Since becoming a father, a short time I have seen God work in amazing ways. And one of them that really captured, I guess just a little bit of guilt inside me and showed me what I was missing was the other night, about a month ago, we were saying our prayers, and I said, "Well, Aubrey, what are you thankful for?" And she, of course, went through Mommy and Daddy and Grammy and Papa and went through the whole family, it seemed like. And she got to the end, and she said, "Our house, our food, and goldfish." And I just thought, wow, what if I looked inside deep down and thanked God for the seemingly tiny, insignificant blessings in my life? How much more full would I feel? And it made me cry, because this kid was thanking God for the littlest thing it was probably huge for her. And I was like, why can't I do that? Why can't I thank God for all the little things, like waking up every morning, breathing, seeing the sun every morning, giving me another chance to live one more day. If I was as joyous as a child, how much more rich would my life be? So as I reflected on that, this whole set list came through, because these are all the songs that she sings and loves. And boy, was it just a perfect list that God gave us. So let's pray. Let's praise God. This next song is called None Like You. God gave everything. There's none like Him, no other like Him. And He knows every beat of your heart and every piece of your soul. So let's sing together. Keep that in mind. Praise God like a child this morning.
Who wore the heavens as royal robes, fashioned the morning in heavenly hosts? Who gave the word when all things were new? Oh God, it's You. It's You who fixed His heart firm upon man, knowing the cause before He began. Who gave Himself when all things were new? Oh God, it's You. It's You.
I'm sorry for my doubt, for my unbelief, and for running through the motions every day. Bring us back, Lord, as we run to you this morning. We pray that this worship is meaningful and pleasing to you. Help our hearts, Lord, open them, break down our walls. Give us clear eyes and ears to hear your word. Help us see you and your love like a child and every little blessing you give us, Lord. We'll run to you, Father. We run to you this morning. We lay it all down at your feet. We praise the most holy and high God. There is none like you. All the earth and all of heaven sings praises to your name. We do too, Lord. We love you. We thank you for this morning. Lord, be with us as we run to the Father. I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. My soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again and again and again. Oh, 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 my heart has been in your sights long before my first breath. Running into your arms is running through life from death. And I feel the surrender deep in my chest. Your mercy is calling out. Just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now. I'll run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend, and so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 again and again and again. Oh, oh,
what mess we have created with our sin. Lord, you forgive us and you take us new every single day. Thank you for your blood of your Son, and thank you for that chance to live for you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. It is good to see you all together. It's good to be here with you. Thank you for being here with us. Welcome. If you're new, or maybe just happen to walk in the door, or I don't know. My name's Doug Betts. I'm the children and youth pastor here. Just want to extend a warm welcome to you this morning. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for those of you that are joining us online. We also appreciate you being with us as well. If you are new or you'd like to learn more about our church, first thing I would encourage you to do is check out the bulletin, as there's lots of information about things that are going on and ways that you can contact us to learn more about who we are. One of those ways is a little response card that's on the back page of the bulletin. You can tear that off, fill that out, and then drop that in one of the boxes located by the doors as you come into the sanctuary. On the back side of the response card, there's actually a little prayer card. So if you have anything that you would like for us as a church to be praying with you about, I would encourage you to fill that out, and then you can also put those in the boxes as you come into the sanctuary. We'd love to hear from you. A second way that you can learn more is stop by and visit with the folks at the Welcome Center. They can help answer questions. If they don't have an answer, they can at least point you in the right direction. It would give you somebody to talk to. Especially for those of you folks that are online, you can stop by our website at beloitfcc.org and learn more there. And then, of course, at the end of the service, Pastor Cliff and myself will be available at the doors as you leave. We'd love to meet you if we haven't, visit with you. If you have anything that you'd like to pray about, we would love to pray with you at that time. I would just encourage you as we're closing to just come out, and we'd love to pray with you also. A couple things that I want to highlight quickly from the bulletin. One, a reminder, questions and conversations happens tomorrow night. That happens the first Monday of every month. It is with Pastor Cliff. It takes place in the library at 7 o'clock, and it's just it's basically exactly what it says. It's an opportunity to ask questions, have conversations, find answers, and that is open to anyone who has questions or would like to have conversation. The second thing is we still have a need for childcare nursery. During our what is normally our 10:30 service, we provide childcare. We still need five people who are willing to step in and serve in that area. Thank you, Kendra. She filled one of those spots, and we are thankful for that. But we still have five more spots, which also reminds me, we had a thing a long time ago that we used to do called Kids Church, but then we didn't have volunteers, and now we don't do it. I don't know. I'm not sure. That may be whatever it is, but I know it aches me a little bit when things like that happen, because I know there are folks who would be here right now if they had a place that their child guy actually talked to a mother earlier today about that. So I'd encourage you to pray, and if God is calling you, and maybe this isn't for you, I don't know, but see where he's calling you to serve, and then do it, and then follow up. I would encourage you to do that. I'd love to talk with you about that. And then finally, Robert Davis asked me to ask Dave Cordell to come up here, so I don't know what's going on, but I don't know. Anyway, okay.
Why don't you come over here? I can, on my good arm, my good arm side. Dina, would you come? Cliff, Laura, would you please come? This is Pastor Appreciation Month, and I don't know, there's a little bit of honoring us in us. We always kind of wait to the last minute thinking maybe we forgot. You know, we want to keep them on their toes. But, and as you can see, I'm handicapped. So I've asked a little lady there, Mackenzie, if you want to come up. And she's going to help me today.
Okay.
If you'll just stand with me here. And I'm going to read something first, okay? And it's Ephesians 4, starting with verse 11. And it says, he gave some as apostles and some as prophets, evangelists and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the works of service, to the building up of the body, of Christ. Until we all attain the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children tossed back and forth by every wind and wave, carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what by every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causing the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. And that pretty well tells us the purpose of those who have been called to fill these positions of apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastors, and teachers. That's to bring us into maturity, the fullness of Christ, that we can come together and be unified. And we thank you all for answering that call. And Dave and Linda, they're not here, but we'll get them later. But we thank you for answering that call, all of you. It is through the answering of that call that we can experience the washing of God's word and the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit. And we thank you for that, that you'd answered that, because you are what we need. We thank you for that. And we thank you for the ministry of your word, and that you take it very seriously, and we appreciate that. So if you would give Pastor Cliff this envelope and shake his hand and say, we love you.
Thanks.
Did you shake Laura's hand too? Got to be diplomatic here. And this young couple over here, not that you're not young. Yeah. We thank you guys. God bless you. And thank you, Sarah.
I helped her up and then I didn't help her down, so that was good. Good morning, church.
It's so good to have you here. I know this is a music Sunday, but you guys sounded awesome singing. I mean, you know what it reminds, it sounds like an army, but it's a different kind of army because we don't fight with the weapons of the world, we fight with the love of God. And so it's just beautiful hearing you sing. And you guys maybe online were singing loud enough I could hear you too. It was really wonderful. So thank you for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Right now would have been a time when we were gonna call Russ and Etta Bauk up. And so I don't know if you got the email late, Etta came down with COVID, and so they weren't able to be with us this morning, and I can just tell you, she was super disappointed. She and Russ were super disappointed that they could not be here, because they love you. They love the support that they've received from us as a church, and so we're real grateful that they're back home now in Colorado Springs, but they're not, I know Etta's not feeling real well. And even while she was not feeling well, she made a video for us that we're going to take some time to watch here this morning in place of them being here in person. But I think you'll see her heart and get an update on what Russ and Etta have been doing. They work through OC International, and they're one of the missionaries that we support regularly as a church from our budget and many, many individuals. So let's listen to what Etta would have to share with us this morning.
Well, hello, friends in Beloit. Russ and I so were looking forward to being with you all in person for this time on Sunday, and probably heard that we tested positive for COVID in spite of our vaccination, but we don't feel great, but we especially did not want to endanger any of you who might be more vulnerable than us, so decided to come back to Colorado Springs and try recording this little session to send to you an update. So we appreciate your graciousness, and I'm going to just share my screen here and see if I can bring you up to date on some things that have been going on with us and maybe leave you with a few thoughts. Okay. I like to look at Romans 10, 14 to 15 today, and if we had a title for this little update, I guess it would be Beautiful Feet. So This is very familiar, but Romans 10 says, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And Russ and I just want to thank you all for sending our feet so that we can bring the good news to some other places in the world. And now it is my privilege to help send the feet of others through preparing them and training them to go to other places. So I'd like to update you a little bit on what we've been doing. This picture is from 2018 when we came home for a furlough, and we shared with you through our tears that Russ had been diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's. He was 59 when he was diagnosed. And we knew for a while he hadn't been feeling well for a long time, and we were noticing more cognitive issues. And so he got the diagnosis in Manila, but we had it confirmed in the US. So we knew that there were some big decisions coming up and probably some big changes for us. And so I want to just share with you a little bit this morning about what we have been doing since that time. I took a new job called the Director of Prefield Ministries at our home office. And this means that I work with our newest missionaries from the time they are accepted in our organization to the time they leave for the field. And we call that a deployment. And I walk with them kind of like a case manager through many logistical questions and problems. But I also direct three different trainings that are required for them to have before we will send them overseas. So it's actually been a good fit for me and a lot of fun to work with these new missionaries. We jumped right in. And so, you know, I started, as I learned the job, jumped into several trainings and just found, you know, I'm trying to figure out how to teach adults now instead of teenagers. Not always that different, but it was a lot of fun, and I've learned a lot and have been able to bring some of my ideas to the mix too. 2020 brought some interesting things for all of us, but early in 2020, in February, I had an opportunity to go to a training course in Egypt. It was a course for those who help others learn language and culture acquisition. And this course had never been offered in North America, so had to go somewhere else to get it. But it was offered in Egypt, and so thought this was a great opportunity. It was a 2-week course. So I went to that, and as a lot of you know, my little brother Mark lives in Cairo. He teaches at the American University of Cairo. So Russ was able to come with me and hang out with Mark and his family. Our daughter Aubrey, who works in the country of Jordan, came while we were there too. So when I wasn't at the course, we had some fun together. They had fun without me too. Well, I wasn't, of course. But anyway, fun fact, on these pyramids, we were told when we toured these that Moses looked at the exact same pyramids that we were looking at. So, you know, that was really amazing. COVID totally blew up in the 3 weeks we were gone. I mean, when we went, it was just kind of in China. When we came back, you know, it was everywhere. And the day after we got back, no more travel from Europe, which we had just traveled through Europe to get home. And the next day, the NBA canceled their season. You know the rest. But anyway, I had been planning a 3-week training event, which is our main training event for our people getting ready to go out. It's called CORE, and it's the CORE training. But like many of you, we all had to make a lot of adjustments. And so that training in June had to be canceled. And we went to an online format for part of the session. So we did 12 sessions that year online. And discovered there's, you know, some pros and cons, but definitely some pros in the things we did online. But we were still reserving 2 weeks for getting together in person for the more experiential parts of our training. So we were hoping that happened in August. That got canceled. But we finally were able to get together in October, in really a perfect window before another surge happened, at least in Colorado, with a smaller group. And we practiced a lot of COVID protocols. But we were so happy to get this group together and get their training accomplished in October of 2020. And then as we moved into 2021, I was really happy we had done that in October, because some of our people really were able to deploy. And this is one gal who is working with refugees, mostly from North Africa, in a European city where many of them migrate to. And so she was able to go in January of this year. And so we were really happy that things had fallen into place for her to be able to do that. And then, you know, as we kind of turned into 2021 and we started planning the next core event, we were pretty thrilled to actually be able to do it. We still did some virtual sessions ahead of time, but then we were able to come together. We had 18 adults, which is actually a really good number for us. And for just coming off of a year of COVID, it really felt like a God thing in terms of bringing these people together, and that many who, you know, our mobilization department had not been able to be out meeting with people, going to Bible colleges and seminaries or anything like that. So these are people God brought to us, and we had a really good time of training up in the mountains of Colorado. I love this picture. It's probably hard for you to sort out. This was also in a recent newsletter, but I have two bulletin boards in my office. One bulletin board has pictures of those that I'm working with currently, trying to help them through their steps to get out the door and to the field. But then when they are deployed to their field, I move them to this other bulletin board. And my admin assistant actually put them together in this way that you see in this picture. So this picture represents the people that have left for the field since I took this job. And interestingly, seven of these pictures represent people, singles or couples, who have left in 2021. So in spite of all the COVID-y things going on around the world, God has still been moving and people have been leaving. So this, of the people we've sent this year, we've sent a couple to Black Forest Academy, which is a missionary kid school in Germany, Nepal, Brazil, Malawi in Africa, Faith Academy, which is the missionary kid school that I taught at in Manila, the gal who's working with refugees in Europe, India, and then another couple. He's a professional coach and she's a professional counselor, and they are using their skills to serve our missionaries around the world. So it was great working with them too. So this represents the goal of what I do, is helping these people and their beautiful feet go to bless the nations and to share the good news of Jesus. So this has been a really busy and productive year in spite of everything. I would ask you to keep praying. I do have another couple. They've had their support raised for over a year, but they cannot get into the country they're going to because of all the COVID restrictions, and it's gotten worse there, not better. And so anyway, we just keep praying, and we've considered some other options of maybe where to, you know, send them to a different place first and all this. But anyway, it's quite a journey for them. I would appreciate your prayer for them. People often ask how Russ is doing, and here he is. We joined the Walk to End Alzheimer's this year in Colorado Springs, and it was a pretty meaningful event for us to participate in. You know, he's it's been rough, and he's really had a lot of sadness over all of his losses. You know, as he said, I wasn't done yet. But we are trying to adjust to this new season of life and rest in the fact that he is a beloved son of God, whether he's helping facilitate church planting all over the Philippines or whether he's learning to walk faithfully day by day with Alzheimer's in Colorado Springs. Some of you that get our letter saw our last newsletter. I brought some extras to share when we would be with you at church, but obviously we're not there. Maybe I think the church offices would have a copy of that letter if you're interested. But I shared with our readers and supporters a liturgy that our daughter Aubrey wrote for her dad, just expressing things she'd heard him say and some of his despair about having Alzheimer's. And then just some reminders from God's word and what we know to be true. So it's really kind of a beautiful biblical lament and something that we're learning a lot about. And we've gone back to those words and other words from scripture a lot and have been encouraged by that. So we appreciate your prayers as we continue to walk through this. Our mission, of course, have been very supportive in us doing, me working and Russ being a part of things as much as he can and doing whatever we need to do to make it work. So we've been really blessed by that. Just again, to wrap up, I want to thank you for sending Russ and I, sending our feet to the other side of the world and even now to Colorado so that we can be a part of sending other people and their beautiful feet to bring the good news of Jesus to the places that haven't heard of him, the places that need to hear the good news. So thank you so much. Russ and I, as we journey on, we know that we cannot do what we do without the love and support of you, or churches and individuals who have really stood by us in prayer and finances. And I have told the appointees that I work with right now, and they're at the beginnings of, you know, raising support and finding their prayer team and their support team. And I have been able to tell them what a blessing you all have been to us and how I understand God's plan in the interdependence of the body of Christ, because especially in these last couple of years where we've been facing such challenges, but we have felt so loved and cared for and prayed for. So I feel like that's part of God's good plan for all of us. So thank you so much again. Hopefully we'll see you in person before too long. Bye-bye.
And that's a good lead-in for our prayer time. We want to be praying for Russ and Etta. That journey's a hard one. And the Bible says, mourn with those who mourn, rejoice with those who rejoice. So we want to do both of those things for Russ and Etta. And as the Holy Spirit prompts you, reach out to them. So we want to pray for them, but we also want to pray for other needs. Or praises, as you give testimony to what God has been doing, how God is good in your life. This is our open prayer time, so if you have anything that you'd like to share, I'll lead us in prayer in just a little bit, but want to get to hear from some of you. If there's something you'd like to share, just raise your hand, and I'll do my best to spot you, and we'll go from there. Yeah. Sure will. Howard's thanking everyone who's reached out to he and McKinley on the passing of Howard's dad recently, and just your cards and responses have meant a lot to him. So we thank God with you for that, Howard. Someone else who'd like to hear? Yeah. Sure will. So Teresa's mentioning this is their last Sunday. They're going to leave to go back. Are you guys leaving later today even yet? Or is it, yeah, later today to go back to Germany. And so we want to be praying for you guys that trip is covered by the Holy Spirit, gets you there safely. And also thank you for encouragement on the passing of Melva and your expressions of love to the family for that. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So we're going to continue to pray for Oliver. And so it sounds like the number of things. One, we're glad that they figured out, so glasses will help. We're going to pray for that. But for that mass, that they'll be able to do that operation, we're going to pray for God's healing and direction, since they're not sure, it sounds like, yet exactly where that surgery is going to take place. But we're going to pray the Holy Spirit is continuing to work in that situation. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. That's fantastic. Yeah,
Dave. I do want to thank the body for their prayers. I'm asking the Lord for accelerated recovery. There's too much to do.
Sure. So, Dave, go ahead.
And also, pray for our nation.
Sure, sure. So Lori's given thanks because we did pray for Dave. We anointed him with oil before his surgery, and he hasn't used any pain meds. Either that's God's grace or Dave's stubbornness. I don't know which one that goes. We're going to give it to God's grace. God's good. And so we're grateful that you're doing so well after that. And then continue prayers for our nation as well. Yes. Absolutely. So Christy's given thanks. Brooke and Phil had the FFA national trip, and that went well. But then she's got a wedding coming up here. Brooke's getting married, and so we rejoice with you, and lots of prayers that will be a blessed time. Yes. Dean is asking for prayer for Lauren, who has mono, but is also getting her tonsils out on Friday. And so we want to pray that God will bring her healing back to full health. Quinn? So we're going to give thanks with you for another great grandchild, Quinn, and doing well then. And so we're glad for and grateful for the health that God has given there as well. Yes. Yeah, Bryce is asking for prayers for Christians around the world who are being persecuted. And so remember the persecuted church. Yes.
I just want to thank you, everybody, for your prayers. And just with the passing of Terry, we're going to have times of sadness and heartache. But yet, I just want to give glory to God and say, God is just, and all his ways are righteous.
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you so much, Lynn. He's giving glory to God. After the passing of Terry, we're going to have his funeral tomorrow. But to glorify God in this moment, thank you for doing that. Someone else, yeah. This is for Matt Lundeen. Lance. Gotcha. He had a reaction to cedar trees. Okay. we're going to pray that the Lord will be with him, help him to get. And he finished 11th while he's reacting to the trees. That's amazing. Yeah. Okay, we certainly will. Someone else, anything you'd like to share? Okay. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use Psalm 103, and I just like to use scripture to prompt me to pray. If it helps you, I hope that this is something that maybe you might consider for your own prayer life. Just using scripture, I just try to take a verse or two, and you'll hear me read it. But what I just try to do off of that is just try to get my heart to kind of dig into that. Like, what's God saying in his word here that would help me to shape and form the way that we pray? And so I'm going to do that with Psalm 103, and then incorporate these requests and praises that you've brought to attention here this morning. But the ultimate goal is just pray. Block me out. If I'm a distraction, block me out. Make sure it's between you and the Lord. So let's pray together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this wonderful psalm inspired by the Holy Spirit. And Lord, in your word it says, "Praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name." And Father, you are our holy Father. You are our creator. And you're the only one who again today gives us life and breath. You are the Holy One, which means you're perfectly good in every way. You're full of grace and truth. You're full of light. For in you, Father, there is no darkness. And we worship you this day because we recognize every good and perfect gift that we have ever experienced, that we'll receive again tomorrow, it all comes from you. And so help us, Lord. This is our prayer. Father, help us to see your glory. Because if we can see you as you are, then, Father, you become our greatest treasure. Our greatest pleasure is in serving and worshiping you. Lord, your word says, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love." So, Lord, we give you thanks for your compassion and your grace, because every one of us here again today, we are broken people. We're broken by our sin. We're enslaved by our sinful desires. And we need you to save us, not just to help us, Lord, but to save us. And with a little bit of fear and trembling, we give thanks for your love, which sometimes allows us to suffer, but to see this as a grace, that it reminds us that we're not in control, and that it would turn our hearts to you. We thank you, Father, for painful but loving discipline that you give us as a sign that we truly are your children. We thank you for being slow to anger and completely patient. Because, Father, to be honest, there's a lot of days we're content to stay exactly as we are. But then you insist on finishing the good work that you've begun in us. So give us hearts, Father, to work with you. And thank you for your love that abounds beyond what we can even imagine. Lord, your word says that you will not always accuse, nor will you harbor your anger forever. You do not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. Could there be any better news? So God, I pray right now that you would remove from our minds distorted views that we have of you. Any view that would see you as perpetually angry and disappointed with us. Any view that would see this view of you, God, that you are a God who keeps a long memory of what we've done wrong. But instead,
to give us this truth, drive it deep, Father, that you are safe to approach in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. In no other name can we approach you, but in Jesus, we're safe. So we confess our sins because you are faithful and just, and you will forgive us our sins in Jesus' name. And we confess them now, not in hopes that by making this confession, that somehow we're going to be more acceptable to you, but in the truth that Jesus has made us acceptable. And now we confess them because, Father, we want to be like you. So hear us as we just silently confess our sins to you now. It's ugly, Lord, when we confess our sins. But then this good word from your word, for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. You give grace in place of condemnation. And Father, when our guilt and our shame would overrun us, you tell us that you've taken our sins and removed them. You don't just forgive our sins, Lord, you remove them. They can't haunt us anymore because they're removed. They can't control us anymore, for they're removed. They can't come against us anymore because there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So we worship you, Lord, in joy, for setting us free from the bondage of our sin. Father, your word says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. Oh, we are, Lord. You know how needy we are. It's good and right of us to confess that and to come to you and know you as our compassionate Father, so that all of these requests that we make before you, we know we have not only your ear, we have your heart. So we lift up Russ and Etta to you, Lord. Lord, we're disappointed that they couldn't be with us. I know they are too. We just pray that right now, at home where they're at, that you, by your Holy Spirit, would encourage them, would lift them up, would let them know that even right this very moment, we're praying for them. We love them, Lord, and as they have a difficult journey, we pray that you are with them with full grace and mercy. God, we pray for those who mourn and grieve in our church family and those in our community. Lord, for the families of Terry Schamberg and George Graben and Melva McGuinn, and Don Creer, and Sandy Nelson, and Howard Bates Sr. Lord, as they grieve and as they mourn, we pray for your hope, the hope of the gospel, in our tears, in our sorrow, that you would lift them up, that you would strengthen them. God, we give thanks. I give thanks especially for a good report on my mom's PET scan. God, that you've been gracious, that she's doing well. Lord, we continue to lift up 17 missionaries who were kidnapped in Haiti and are still being held. We pray, God, against the fear that's trying to close in on them. We pray you strengthen them and bring them safely home again. Lord, we pray along with thanks with Howard for the responses of love and caring that he's received in the passing of his dad. We give thanks also with Teresa for that same kind of encouragement and love in the passing of Melva. Thank you, God, that you really have made us a body that feels with one another, cares for one another. We do lift up Teresa and Paul as they'll be leaving for Germany on this long journey again, Lord, and they've been making a lot of miles here. We just pray, God, that you would continue to be with them and keep them safe, give them extra energy and strength. Lord, we lift up little Oliver to you again. We thank you, Lord, as the doctors continue to figure out next steps for him. We pray that the glasses would be great and helpful for him. But Lord, for this mass around his eye, we would pray again. And we pray this boldly, God, because you are God who can, with a word, bring healing. We pray for healing. God, we pray if you're going to bring that through doctors, that you would guide and direct where that surgery should take place, and already have chosen the surgeon who will do it and be with him or her. God, we give you thanks for so many people that can provide great loving care. We're blessed in that way. Lord, we give thanks along with Lori and Dave for answered prayers as we prayed over Dave before his surgery, and he's doing so well afterwards. We take this as your grace, as your love, your power. Thank you for that, Lord. Pray along with Dave for our nation. Continue to lift up our nation to you, Lord, that you would bless our nation, that you would bless this nation, God, to turn their hearts to you, that in every way we would recognize that you alone are God. God, we pray along with Christy with thanks for Brooke and Phil's recent trip and how well that went, but with a lot of planning to be done here and the excitement of Brooke's wedding, we pray, God, that you would bless Brooke and Jace, that their lives together would truly reflect the unity, the love that comes from you. Lord, we pray along with Dina for Lauren, who's got mono. God, we pray that you would bring healing to help her feel better, and then especially to be with her on Friday as she has her tonsils out, God, that you would overcome any fear, let her know your presence in a unique and special way, I pray. Lord, we pray along with Donna with joy for an 18th great-grandchild, for Quinn, for the health that he has, for a safe delivery, and for the blessing that this is for family. Bless Donna's family, we pray. Lord, our hearts go along with Bryce as our hearts go out for other believers, because the body of Christ is not just us here, it's around the world. And many of our brothers and sisters are being persecuted even now. We gathered here together, God, without an ounce of fear, without any thought that we could gather in your name safely. But other brothers and sisters, God, we pray that you would encourage them as they do that in secret, as they do that with great pain and suffering, that, God, you'd be glorified through them and in them. Be with them, we pray. Lord, we give great thanks for Lynn's testimony after the passing of Terry here, that you are good, that you are a holy God, and that you're with her, you're with the family. We pray, God, your blessing on the family. God, we pray for Lance Lundin, for his run that he's had, and he did well, but he's struggling, he's suffering a little bit health-wise and with some reaction to some cedar trees. We just pray, God, your health would come to him, that it would be a touch from you. And in all of these situations, God, when we ask for healing, where we ask for health, we pray that it would be really clear that it doesn't just happen, that it's from you, that you would truly be glorified. So God, thank you that we can bring all of these things. There is no small thing, as Tristan was saying. Everything is yours. And so our lives belong to you. We look to you for all things. And your word says that the Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. So we say it again, Lord, because our hearts can't hear this enough. You are in control. You reign over all things. And no matter how bad things may seem to get, that you call us to live in a confidence that your sovereign rule holds all things together and is working for the good of those who love you. Help us to have peace in knowing that you are the King. Help us to have hope in knowing your will be done. Help us to have joy in knowing that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So prompt us each day, Lord, to be salt and light, to be in this world but not of this world. We don't place our hope in politics or position or earthly power, but in the unstoppable strength of your kingdom. Help us to live as aliens and strangers in this world, for our citizenship is in heaven with you. And Lord, your word says, praise the Lord, you his angels, you his mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts and his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Amen.
Good morning, church, and all people online. If you're online, go get some bread and some juice, and you can have communion with us today. Here at BFCC, we have open communion. All we ask that you have a belief that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. You're welcome to come up. When you come up, we'll get the plates. There's two cups. The bottom one's the bread. The top one's the juice. You can come up here and pray as long as you want. You're more than welcome. Then put your cups on the side, and we'll go from there. We're going to have a little video here, and this video hit my heart. I went into this really hard. I saw it last week in Detroit. And it shows a guy who's suffering. And I felt like I was one of the guys that put this bad sticker on this guy. I know people come in the clinic and you just go, man, what is this guy? And it really hit my heart. And I thought, how am I going to use this for communion without doing this? So just watch this, and hopefully that's you too. We have all felt like this guy. Some of the stickers said unloved, stupid, nerd, clumsy. The words put on us hurt. People put on us hurt. But the word love means a lot to us. It makes the person feel that warm, fuzzy inside. With being loved, all of the other stigmas don't matter. All those stickers came off them. The person got the love card, I called it. And did you notice what he did with the love card? He passed it on. What does this have to do with communion? Jesus showed us how much he loved us by paying the ultimate sacrifice, by dying on a cross, shedding his own blood and his broken body to save us from our sin. But we as Christians need to also pass the love card off to someone else, like the guy in the clip, so they can feel the love of Jesus Christ also. Come celebrate this love with us now. Deacons, you want to come forward? Let us pray. Lord, thank you for the love you have showed us, and may it help us lift off the burdens of this world. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I want to take a moment for another mission moment. Many of you are aware, and if you're not, we want to make you aware. Every year we do Operation Christmas Child, which is a really practical way to make a difference in the lives of kids all over the world. We have the table in the back, and Chris Miller is always there to answer any questions that you might have about Operation Christmas Child. But we want you to watch this video that shows the impact that Operation Christmas Child can have in the lives of people as it touches them in many different ways. So let's watch this video.
I've had an interesting upbringing. In my journey, I've experienced God's love in the form of people reaching out when they don't have to tangibly demonstrate God's love. That love along the way has been unconditional, never ending, generous, always giving, powerful love that has changed hearts, and most personally, my very own. My family is originally from Rwanda. In July of 1994, a lot of the chaos started, and Hutus were killing Tutsis killing Hutus. My mom was 8 months pregnant. They had just built a new house, and my dad realized that with two young boys and one daughter, they need to get out. And that's when they decided to flee to the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo. And I was born a month later there. Then after that, we bounced around the world because we had nowhere else to go. And that's when we moved to Togo. So I was a refugee for 14 years of my life. I've never met any of my grandparents, my uncles, my cousins. Many of them were killed. And it's not just my family. A million people fell in the span of 100 days in the Rwandan genocide. Knowing that fact broke me as a kid. I was wary of humanity because I knew what they were capable of, the evil they were capable of. And I harbored a hatred for them, a radical hatred for them. I grew up calling myself a Christian. But my faith wasn't my own, it was my parents. My parents there were pastors in Togo, and heard the gospel, read the Bible, but none of it reached me, really. Because of hardened heart, pride, just hatred, over and over I walked away from God's love. But he was always there. You know, something that changed the course of my life was my first gift, the first gift I'd ever received. As I opened the shoebox, the items in there were incredible. The first thing I remember pulling out was a scarf that I still have. There was a red toy car in my box. That was my favorite item that day. At the very top was a sticky note, the The words on that sticky note read, God loves you, Jesus loves you, I love you. Now, I had heard those first two lines before, but that last one wrecked me. Because it was an I love you from a member of that very humanity I grew up hating. And they were telling me essentially, Eve, despite your hatred for me, I love you anyway, man. And here's proof of my love for you in the form of the first and only gift you've ever received. That shook my world to the core. And God began to use that sticky note to start working on my heart. It didn't happen overnight. I'm still a work in progress. His love never left our side. His ever-flowing, never-ending, always giving, generous, powerful love. And then a shoebox gift. That's what God used to free me from the burdens of hatred. I have never been the same because of that shoebox that still continues to change my life.
Love is stronger than evil. And this is, again, a really practical way. It's a great way for families to do something together, is to pack a shoebox and then pray over it, let the Holy Spirit take it exactly where it needs to go. But don't underestimate what God can do through a simple shoebox. We just want to remind you that November 21st is the last day to bring your shoeboxes, filled shoeboxes, back here to the church so that they can be sent out on time. So consider that, pray about that if you would. Now I'd like to shift gears just a little bit here, and we're going to celebrate. What we want to do is I want to ask Joe and Samantha Fugate if they'd come up, because we're going to celebrate the fact that God has brought them here to our church, celebrate the fact that, I always joke about this, against all odds, they like you, they want to be with you, they want to be a part of our church. They're a blessing. We're so blessed to have you guys if you come up here to be with us as a church. They've expressed their desire to join in membership, and for us that's a big deal. We love that. It flows for us in an order of priority, so I just want to explain. I always try to explain this because a lot of folks don't understand always how we see things, but for us, our first and most important thing, it's the mission for us as a church, is to make disciples for Jesus Christ. And so the first priority for us before membership, before baptism, is have you received Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord? And so I just want to ask Joe and Samantha that question right now, a chance for you to express that publicly. Have you received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Awesome. And so for us, that's the most important thing. If you're here and you haven't done that yet, anything that we can do to encourage you, to bring you near to Jesus, that's what we want to do. So they've done that, and that, of course, is a great joy that they are a part of the body of Christ with us in that way. A sign that that has happened in our lives is baptism. Jesus said not only to make disciples, but then to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to ask Joe and Samantha, have you been baptized as a sign that you've received Christ?
Yes.
Awesome. And so they have taken that step with us. And then for us, membership then makes sense. If those two things are in order because those are commanded in Scripture, then we think it makes sense to celebrate this as a sign. This is a sign right now. The Holy Spirit, this isn't an accident. This is the Holy Spirit has brought them here to be with us. The Holy Spirit has prompted them to want to connect with us as a church family. And so I would just ask them, is it your commitment then to listen for the Holy Spirit, and as the Holy Spirit directs you and guides you to use your particular gifts and talents in the body of Christ for the kingdom of God, is that your commitment to give yourself fully to us as a church in that way?
Yes.
Awesome. Would you then, as a church, express this back? They got enough courage to come up here today. We want you to express love and really genuine in this response. Do you, as the body of Christ here at Beloit First Christian Church, do you promise to love on Joe and Samantha and their family as the Holy Spirit guides you, listening for the Holy Spirit to prompt you on how to love them best in every way, using your gifts and talents together with theirs Do you promise to do that? Make that commitment from your heart so that they know that, they feel secure in that. If so, say, we sure do. There you go. Hey, that's for you. So let me take this moment then just to pray, because we want to seal this moment in the Holy Spirit. So let's pray. Thank you, Father. You are good. God, in all the struggles of life, it is by your wisdom that we would not go it alone, that you would bring us together in real fellowship, real bonds of connection that go beyond what we might have in common or not, to the very core of who we are, which is Christ. Thank you that for Joe and Samantha, they have that hope in Christ that we share with them. And we pray, God, that this would be a great moment of joy and celebration then. As we walk together in this journey, we pray that you would keep them alert to your Spirit, keep us alert to your Spirit, so that we walk in step with your Spirit together. I pray this is a blessing for them and that they will find continued joy here in the body of Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That's a good amen right there. Would you just encourage them as they go back to their seats?
Spirit of living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice, we're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more, we're hanging on every and speak to us, O Lord. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice, we're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more, we're hanging on every word. Cause when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, changes what we see and what we seek. When you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. You're changing everything. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we're leaning into all you are, everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts, come now and have your way. When you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, changes what we see and what we seek. When you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. Yeah. You're changing everything. When you move us to tears. can you do what only you can do? It changes us, it changes what we see, what we see. When you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see, what we see. Changing everything. The Spirit of the Living God, Spirit of the Living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every Father to the fatherless, defender of the weak, freedom for the prisoner, we sing. This is God in his holy place. This is God clothed in love and strength. can to you. What can I offer to a king for all the love you've shown? For all your mercy over me, I called your name, you heard my cry out of the grave and into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. The rock of salvation, my hope is built on nothing less. Morning by morning, how great is your faithfulness. I called your name, you heard my cry out of the grave and into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. You gave your life upon the cross. You suffered once for all. You made a way. Jesus, in victory you rose. You made us all your own. Now we are saved. You gave your life upon the cross. You suffered once for all. You made a way. Jesus, in victory you rose. You made us all your own. Now we are saved. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me, for saving me. 'Cause I called your name, and you heard my cry out of the grave and into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, God, for saving me, for saving me.
Lord, we thank you for today. What a perfect song that we could sing and worship you with right before baptism. Lord, as we go about our day, help us remember your love. You saved us all, and you live in and through us every day. Help us remember. Help us know you are here. Lord, we love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Seem like the perfect way to end this service today is to celebrate baptism. We have a real brave guy here. This is Liam Fugate, and Liam has expressed a desire to be baptized. And for us, that's a big deal. We see this as a powerful sign of God at work in Liam's life. And so we're really, really grateful for this. For us, baptism is a sign. It doesn't save anyone. It's not something that in itself is sufficient, but what it does is it reveals that there's a saving work that's already been happening in Liam's heart. And so his desire to be obedient to Jesus is a big deal, and so we're grateful that he wants to do that. So the only requirement for us is not height. You don't have to be a certain height of any kind. It means that your heart has responded to Jesus. So Liam, I'm just going to ask you that one question we talked about. Have you accepted Jesus as your Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, that's a strong yes right there. That's right. And again, that's important. That means he's not afraid to get up and say, yeah, I belong to Jesus. And so we celebrate that. That's the only requirement for us for baptism. And so, Liam, let's go ahead and do this. I'm going to turn you this way. Yeah, you can put your hands up like that. And Liam, I'm baptizing you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray and seal this moment too. Father, thank you so much for Liam, for his life. You created him, you knit him together, and you already saw this day long before he was even born. And so we thank you that we can celebrate new life by the power of your Holy Spirit, that Liam is born again into your kingdom. And so we pray, God, that this moment would be used not only today, but in the days to come in Liam's life, that he would be able to reflect back on this, and that this sign would be important for him, powerful for him, that you are with him, that your Holy Spirit lives in him. And then whatever dark days he may face, God, that he would find strength in you always. We pray for Liam that you would protect him in the spiritual war that takes place every day, and that through him, your grace, your mercy, your truth would flow, and he'd find his greatest joy in you. So God, he gives us great joy today. We pray for him, we lift him up, and we give you all the thanks and all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Be blessed this week.